Hello everyone, welcome to the 13th session on automatic cryptanalysis. The first talk is on exhausting the Mercy Cell-2 mutated middle attack against reduced round AES. And it's work done by Patrick Derbe and Bernard Vouk. And Patrick is giving the talk.
Thank you for the introduction. So my talk is about the attack of Mercy Cell-2 and which is the core of best known attack on some of Prometheus version of the AES. So the point is to show how to mount many variants of the original attack and also how to show find the best ones among them. So I will begin by the description of the AES. Then I will explain the original attack of Mercy and Cell-2 together with its improvements. After that, I will present our new improvements, and finally, I will combine them to the differential enumeration technique, and I will describe a new attack on HRUNs. So let's begin by the description of the AES. So the competitions to select it began in 97, and the cipher designed by Richman and Diamond won it 4 years later. So it's an iterative block cipher based on the substitution permutation network. It was standardized with a block size of 128 bits and 3 different key sizes. And the number of rounds depends on the key size. So in the AES, each 16-byte block is represented as a 4x4 matrix of bytes, where each byte is seen as an element of the finite field F256. One AES round is composed of 4 simple operations applied successively on the state matrix. So the first one is a subbyte operation that applies the same linear S-box on each byte of the state matrix. Then there is the shift of the operations that shift the rows. Then there is the mix columns operations that multiplies the state matrix by a constant MDS matrix. And finally, there is the add key operations that performs the XOR between the state matrix and the sub K. In some cases, we are interested by swapping the order of the two last operations. And in that case, we will denote the sub K used in the add key operation by U. And it is related to the original sub K by some linear combination. So in this example, I will use some notation. So I denote by X the state just before the subbyte, and by Z the state just after the shift rows. So the AES was successfully designed to be resistant against linear and differential cryptanalysis, and the main concern was about its simple algebraic structure, but it seems that attacks based on SAT solver or Grobner basis algorithm are still far away to break it. So finally, one could say that the AES was broken in the first time by related subkey attacks on the 192 and 256 bit versions, and more recently in the single key model by big leak attacks on the 3 versions. But in the first case, the model is not very realistic, and in the second case, the gain is very marginal. Okay, so let's now talk about the attack of Mercy and Cell-2. First, I have to introduce the definition of a delta set, which is a set of 256 AES states, such that one byte is active and the other ones are constant. And at FSE 2008, Mercy and Cell-2 described a problem property for the AES, which is stated as follows. If we apply 4 AES rounds on the delta set, then for each of the 16 bytes of the final state, the ordered sequence of 256 values of that byte is fully determined by only 25 byte parameters. So as a consequence, the number of possible sequences is negligible compared to the number of theoretically possible. So the proof of this property is very simple. So let's consider the encryption of a delta set where there is no differences in white byte. And assume that we want to build the sequence of 256 values in the circle byte, then we just have to guess the values of the black bytes for one message and propagate the differences from the first state to the last one. Indeed, as we consider a delta set, we already know all differences in the first state. Then by linearity, we can compute all differences in the second one. So we will know all the value of the black bytes for all messages, and we can apply the ZSBox on each of them. And finally, as the other differences are null, we will know all differences in the third state. So we can apply the same technique to obtain the sequences of value of the circle bytes. So Demirci and Selçuk first used this property to mount an attack on seven rooms of the AES 256, which is stated as follows. So first, there is an offline phase where we have to compute all the possible sequences and store them in a hash table. Then, in the online phase, we begin by asking for a structure such that the main diagonal is active and the other bytes are constant, and we choose one of the messages. Then we guess the values of its gray bytes, and we propagate the differences from Z1 to P in order to identify and sort the data set. Then we just guess the values of the black bytes for the chosen message, and we propagate the differences from the ciphertext to the black byte of X5 to compute the sequence of value and check if it belongs to the table. And if it belongs to the table, we know with a probability very close to one that the guessed values was right. And if it doesn't belong to the table, then we know with probability one that at least one guessed values was false. So both parameters of the online and the offline phase are state bytes that we will denote by bion and bioff. And if the subkeys used in the add key operations are independent, then the complexities of this attack is exponential in the size of the sets bion and bioff. And in that case, the memory complexity will be too high to apply this attack on the 128 and 192 bits versions, but the time complexity is low enough to mount an attack on 8 rounds for the AES 256 by just guessing the last subkeys and apply the 7 round attack. But in the AES, the subkeys are not independent, so as the byte of bioff and byte of bion are related by the AES equations, they may assume less value than expected. Indeed, they lead to the knowledge of some key bytes that may be related by the key schedule equations. So we denote those sub-key bytes by KF and KL. So the basic attack of Demirci and Selçuk have been improved. So the first improvement is to consider sequence of differences instead of sequence of values. And that allows us to remove one byte from bion or from bioff. Then it is also possible to store unordered sequences instead of ordered sequences. And that mainly allows us to remove one byte from bion, which was used only to sort the data set. Finally, we can apply a classical data time memory trade-off by storing in the hash table only a fraction of the possible sequences. And in exchange, we have to reduce the attack many times to compensate the probability of failure, and it will increase both the data and time complexity. However, it is possible to save some data in this trade-off by noticing that the structure used in this attack contains exactly 2 to the 24th delta sets. So if we summarize those results, the basic attack of Demirci and Selçuk requires a huge memory and a relatively small time complexity. We can balance these complexities by applying the classical data time memory trade-off. For instance, to apply the 7 rounds attack on the AES 192, but it will increase the data complexity. And for instance, on 7 rounds, the data complexity will be approximately 2 to the 70 chosen plain text. So our first goal was to find how to reduce the data complexity. So first, we noticed that Dimercy and Celsuc sort the dataset according to the value of the active byte of Z1. But in fact, it is unnecessary to know the value of that byte in the offline phase. We just have to know the differences in that byte. So as a consequence, we lose one byte from k off, but it does not change the number of sequences built in the offline phase. But in another end, you can now reduce the delta set 256 times in the data time memory trade off. So it saves some data complexity. Then, we noticed that Dimercy and Celsuc only consider simple cases where the delta set have one active byte and where the check is performed on one byte of X5 or in one byte of Z5. But in fact, the meet in the middle is performed between those two states, and more precisely between the five colored bytes in these two states, because there is a linear combination between the differences in those states. So the idea is to consider different linear combinations, and to do that, we use the fact that the matrix used in the mixed columns operations is an NDS matrix. So as a consequence, we know that minimal equations between those two states involves exactly five bytes on the same column. And the converse is true. If we choose five bytes on the same columns, then there is a linear equation between them. So, in fact, in the offline phase, we compute the part of this equation that involves the byte of Z5. And in the online phase, we compute the part of this equation that involves the byte of X6. So we can consider different attacks like this or this. So basically, we can trade some bytes of B-on against byte of B-off and vice versa, without increasing the data complexity. And without randomizing the attack. So this idea may be applied to the delta set. Instead of considering a set of 256 AS states, such as one byte is active and the other one are constant, we consider a set of 256 AS states, such that exactly five bytes are active between those two states. But in that case, it will affect the size of the structure needed in the attack, so by the way, the data complexity, and also the byte of Z1 must be guessed despite the use of an ordered sequence. So that allows us to mount new variants of the original attack, and once we have chosen the middle round for the offline phase, we can mount approximately 2 to the 16 variants. But the number of sets B-on and B-off to study is a little bit smaller. Then, to compare the corresponding attacks, we have to answer to two related questions, which are how many values can assume the state bytes and how fast can we enumerate them. So this is not an easy case because S-boxes are involved in the key schedules. So we use the tool I developed 2 years ago in a joint work with Charles Bouyaguet and Pierre Lafouque that solves a problem very close to our problem. So basically, this tool takes as input a system of equation E in variables X involving some S-boxes, so an AS-like system of equations. And it returns an optimal algorithm to enumerate all the solutions of this system of equations with a predictable time and memory complexities. So of course, the algorithm returned is optimal among a particular class of solvers. So we made a new tool from the previous one. So now the tool take as input also subset Y of the set of variables X, and it will return a list of optimal algorithms to enumerate all the, possible values of Y according to the system of equations. So basically, the idea is to apply the previous tool to each subset between Y and X, but in fact, by using a good pruning strategy, the number of subsets to consider is often 1 or 2. So the complexity of this tool is exponential in the number of involved S-boxes, since it was the case for the previous tool. So it is really faster to apply it on K and key schedule equations instead of B and AES equations. So thanks to it, we have been able to exhaust all cases for all key size and with or without the last X columns. And for instance, here you can see the results for 7 rounds of the AES 192. So this table gives the log 256 of the data complexity as a function of the number of guests to perform in the offline phase and in the online phase. So as you can see, whatever the complexity we want to reach, all best attacks requires only 2 to the 30 seconds plain text, so as much as the original attack of Demircian Zelsuk. You can also see that we found new attacks with a smaller data complexity. In fact, we find competitive results in the very low data complexity league, with, for instance, attacks up to 8 rounds for the AES 256 that need only 256 plain text. So let's now talk about the differential enumeration technique, which is a technique introduced by Dunkelman, Keller, and Shamir as an alternative to the classical data time memory trade-off. But they didn't realize how powerful was this technique. So we recently improved their result in a joint work with Jérémy Jean. And we have obtained the best known attacks on 7, 8, and 9 rounds. But as you can see, the complexities of the 8 rounds attacks are not balanced, so we can do better. So let's consider this variant of the attack of Demircian Zelsuk, where bytes of Bion are in gray and bytes of Bioff are in black. And now let's consider a pair that follows this differential. Okay. In that case, the possible values for bytes of Bion and bytes of Bioff are very restricted. In fact, if we guess the differences of the circle in the circle byte, then we will know all the differences before and after the S box for each of the black bytes, so we can deduce their value. And as a consequence, there are at most 1 to 128 values instead of 2 to 240 values for byte of Bion. So it's a nice improvement. But now in the online phase, we have to focus on finding a pair that follow this differential. So we begin by asking for a structure such that the diagonal is active and the other bytes are constant. And then we look for pairs that may follow the differential, or in other words, that have a null differences in the Y byte of Z7. Okay? Then, for each of these pairs, we have to find the possible values of bytes of Bion. So this is done essentially by guessing the differences in the circle byte, because in that case we will know the differences before and after the S box for each of the gray bytes, so we will deduce their values. But the real procedure is a little bit more complicated, since we have to take care of relations between gray bytes. Okay. So then Once we have obtained the values of the gray bytes, we can identify a data set that contains the pairs and compute the sequence and check if it belongs to the table. So we and then we restart this procedure until a match occurs, or in other words, until the structures contain the pairs that follow the differential. So as before, we have been able to exhaust all cases, and for instance, on eight rounds, the best results are here. Okay. So it's a gain of we save approximately a factor 2 to the 30 second for the overall complexity on the 192 bits versions, and 2 to the 4C for the 256 versions. It is possible to do a little bit better to save some data for this attack by performing many attacks in parallel, or in other words, by looking for many differentials in parallel without increasing the overall complexity. Okay. So there is some limitation on the case we have been able to try. In fact, we only tried cases where both bytes of Bn and Bf and the active bytes of the pair are synchronized, because else the number of cases to handle may become huge and the complexity of our tool tends to explode. So to conclude this talk, in this paper, we have generalized the attack of Dimir-Cien-Seltzuk. We have been able to find many new attacks that need a small data complexity. We also find best known attacks on eight rounds for the AES-192 and the AES-256, and those results was found in an automatic way. Furthermore, this attack, this is somewhat generic, and it may be applied to many other ciphers. So for instance, we applied it on Square and then on LED, and the result will probably be in the full version. So thank you for your attention.
So are there any questions? I have one, Patrick. Do you think that this tool that could be adapted to obtain some distinguished results on hash functions?
I don't think so.
No.
Now I try to extend it to a different cipher like Twine, in fact, which is a little bit more different than the AES, but for distribution, I don't think so.
Okay, thank you very much. Let's thank the speaker again.